Live? Okay, thank you. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us for the Lewiston City Council meeting. I have some additional comments that I'll make once we get back. Our first item is an executive session, and once we get back, I'll read through some of the logistical stuff. So with that, I'll entertain a motion from the councilor from Ward 1.
I make a motion to enter into an executive session.
And that would be in reference to discussing disposition of property, of which the premature disclosure of the information would prejudice the competitive bargaining position of the city. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay.
I second the motion.
All right. Moved by Councilor Khalid and seconded by Councilor Ray. Call the roll.
Sure. Councilor from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
Ward 5?
Yes.
And Ward 6?
Yes.
And we'll note for the record that the councilor from Ward 7 has an excused absence this evening. So a motion passed by vote of 6-0.
All right, thank you. We're into executive session now, folks.
Kathy, I'm trying to get a hold of Dave to join in to put that posting up. He still hasn't answered his phone yet.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, he's got a sign that MIS always puts up. It has the city seal and it's a nice copy that Matt made. Great.
That might be him right there. I'm trying to get a hold of him. Okay.
Perfect. Thank you.
He's on his way. You may have to explain to him what sign you need, but I tried.
Okay, thanks. I mean, Matt should have given it to him if Dave was covering for Matt tonight. So I'll see. I'll touch base with David when he logs in. Thanks, Dale.
What's that? No, no, everything was fine. The only...
Hey, Dale, you're not on mute?
Oh, I just remuted, so...
Awesome.
Okay, I believe we're ready to go if we can get that screen down. Just a couple of technical difficulties. As soon as we can get this screen down, just for the general public, we'll get right on our meeting. All right, great. Thank you. All right, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the November 17th City Council meeting. The council had met previously and went immediately into executive session. And now we're back to our regular meeting. This session will be conducted remotely and council members will only participate electronically. For those viewing online, please ensure that you join this meeting using the following web address, www.lewistonmaine.gov/2020cc. If you join this meeting using any other link, we would encourage you to log off and then log back on using that link. Public comments on any item appearing on the agenda may be sent to publiccomment@lewistonmaine.gov prior to or during the meeting, and all comments received will be forwarded to the Lewiston City Council. Members of the public who are logged into the meeting online can also make comments when invited to do so by raising your hand, and that's located in your lower center of your screen. Once they are acknowledged, their microphone will be unmuted and they will be invited to make a brief comment. Speakers will also need to be sure to unmute their mics as well. And councilors are asked to raise their hand to make comments. Councilor Lee Clement was with us previously, but has developed some technical issues and will not be able to join us for the remainder of the meeting. With that said, Madam Clerk, if you could just please call the roll for attendance.
Sure. Councilor from Ward 1?
Here.
Ward 2?
Here.
Ward 3?
Present.
Ward 4?
Here.
And Ward 5?
Present.
And we'll note for the record that the Councilor from Ward 6 and the Councilor from Ward 7 both have excused absences this evening. Also present for the meeting is the Deputy City Administrator, Dale Dowdy, Finance Director, Heather Hunter, and myself as the City Clerk. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. You could read into the record the 2020 Small Business Saturday Mayoral Proclamation.
Sure, so we have a mayoral proclamation honoring the 2020 Small Business Saturday event, and I'll read the proclamation. Whereas the City of Lewiston appreciates its small businesses and the contribution they make to the local economy and community, and Whereas the fact that the Saturday after Thanksgiving is widely celebrated around the country as Small Business Saturday is a positive opportunity for Lewiston businesses. And whereas, according to the United States Small Business Administration, there are 30.7 million small businesses in our nation, and residents are encouraged to support small businesses and merchants on November 28th, 2020, and throughout the entire year. And whereas in 2019, United States consumers reported spending a record high total of an estimated $19.6 billion at independent retailers and restaurants on Small Business Saturday. And whereas our local businesses are struggling amidst the COVID-19 pandemic, and participating in Small Business Saturday 2020 will provide a bit of hope in this challenging time of uncertainty. And whereas 97% of consumers who have shopped on Small Business Saturday agree that small businesses are essential to their community. And whereas 96% of American consumers who have shopped on Small Business Saturday agree that shopping at small, independently owned businesses supports their commitment towards making a positive social, economic, and environmental impact. And whereas from delicious meals to many diverse products in Lewiston, shopping local goes a long way in supporting the ability of small businesses to continue operating, especially amidst the pandemic, and builds goodwill. And whereas Lewiston, Maine is thankful for its local businesses as they create jobs, boost our local economy, and help preserve the community as well as our community spirit. Now, therefore, I, Mark A. Kager, Mayor of the City of Lewiston, Maine, do hereby proclaim November 28th, 2020, as Small Business Saturday within our community, and encourage residents to support our local businesses on that day and perhaps consider doing so all year long. Presented this 12th day of November 2020, signed Mayor Mark A. Kager.
Thank you. And now we'll have an update from Deputy City Administrator reference to COVID-19 pandemic situation.
Sure, Mr. Mayor. as I think everyone's aware, COVID cases are increasing throughout the state and also in Androscoggin County. And we're beginning to see some of the effects of that community spread in our workforce. So we're seeing people who've had close contact outside of the city government let us know about that. So we're proceeding with quarantining and testing them. And I think most of you probably saw an article in the paper yesterday of some firefighters that had been exposed, one or more, bringing it into the firehouse and then obviously infecting others because they're in close contact there. We've also had throughout the city at least another positive and quite a few that have had, like I said, that have had close contact that we've been assessing. We're working very closely with CDC. We actually have one of their epidemiologists that we're contact quite often, whether it's a close contact from outside or whether it's something that's occurring inside of the city. And they're assisting us with going through the contact tracing, giving us advice there, giving advice on testing, notification of other employees or non-city staff if we need them to reach out to people outside, if, you know, in a family environment or something like that. Also, we're trying to assess those contacts that have occurred inside of city government and which ones are coming from outside, because that has implications to workers' comp and some other things. Directors are on daily, especially those in public safety, are just assessing their workforce. We haven't gotten close to issues with being able to maintain public safety at all, but just as things increase, they're keeping an eye on that daily and adjusting shifts and making those adjustments on a daily basis. We're also, as you remember, we had continuing operation plans that we developed in each department in the spring when we kind of stepped down city services to essential services. We're not planning to do any of that at this point, but we are reassessing those plans so that they're ready should the governor or the Maine CDC make recommendations. Other than that, we're continuing with the same hygiene practices we've discussed in previous meetings, and really in reinforcing with staff that distance, masking, cleaning of surfaces, you know, washing hands, all of those things. And for the most part, staff's doing a great job.
All right, thank you. Any questions or comments from the council in reference to that update? Councilor Ray.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So this is a conversation we keep having at school committee about instructional availability and remote and not remote, blah, blah, blah. Very important, but a very different conversation when we're talking about City Hall. Is there a threshold at which you would return to the essential services? I'm having a hard time keeping up with all of the info coming down from the state. And it sounds like we are in perhaps one of the more strict phases that we've moved back into. Is there a phase above this that would trigger us doing that? Just curious as to what the threshold is.
Yeah, I think really we take our cues from both the CDC and the governor's office. Like I said, because of just some of the issues around, and I don't think we're any different than really any other business our size right now. So I don't think we're impacted at a greater extent or anything, but we are talking to them on a daily basis. And if they were to recommend it, or if the governor went to the to shelter in place and stay at home orders, those kinds of things, we would definitely look at it at that time. Dennis is out today, but we've been talking about this just about on a daily basis and really trying to keep up with both the numbers in the city, numbers in the county, and the implications to city services. So I don't know that we have a set threshold yet, but we're really keying in on both the governor's office and the CDC.
I think that's super helpful. I think you've kept us all well looped into that, but getting that message out to the public is always important, since they could be impacted by if we have a reduction in in-person services. And I would be remiss if I didn't remind folks that much city business can be done online.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments from the council? Okay, seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to accept the minutes of October 20th and November 10th of 2020.
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
Moved by Councilor LaJoy, seconded by Councilor Jensen. Call the roll.
Councilor from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
And Ward 5?
Yes.
Motion passed by vote of 5-0.
Okay, thank you. Now it's the public comment period. Any member of the public may make comments regarding issues pertaining to Lewiston City Government, maximum of 3 minutes per speaker. Is there anyone from the public that would like to make a public comment? I see one person, Melissa Dunn, with her hand raised. If we could bring in Ms. Dunn. Okay, good evening, Ms. Dunn. I see you just unmuted your mic. Go ahead, please.
Hi, my name's Melissa Dunn. I'm a purposeful homeowner at 254 Blake Street, and I'm a community organizer for Lewiston United for Peace and Hope. Today, I read that 7 fire folks tested positive for COVID. On the 6th of November, I called the department to come to my home because I had an outlet that was on fire. The people that entered my home, I swear about a dozen of them, entered my home without masks on. And what transpired after that for somebody who was poor was a nightmare. I ended up getting money raised in community to spend the night at a hotel because the risk was less than sleeping in my own bedroom where my fire was. Also, I noticed in one of my rooms, my drawers were opened, my books were looked through, and about 3.5 grams of medical marijuana were taken from my bedroom. I reported this. I called the city administrator. I actually am going for my second COVID test tomorrow because of them not wearing masks. Now, the kicker is somebody from the Lewiston Fire Department called me. They said, "You don't seem to understand," and yell at me and question me as though I was lying. They insisted that things that took place in my home. They were insisting things or scenarios took place that didn't take place. Like they weren't there, they weren't present. They were gaslighting me basically in extreme classist. And I literally had to tell them, don't speak to me that way. Do not speak to me that way. I may be poor and I may be uneducated, but I am not stupid. Now, one would think the duality of being in and with community as a neighbor and an organizer would afford me privileges to be heard. But the reality is at the end of the day, I'm still poor, I'm still brown, and I still reside in the downtown. Now I realized tonight with the complaints of Lewiston Police Department and the Fire Department who access our community and they're intentionally accessing our community without masks on. And I literally like dropped to my knees with the realization that people in my community may die from their negligence, and it is intentional. We are one of the poorest communities in New England. And we are often the target of power holders and institutions. And over again, our community is infiltrated by people in powerful positions who do not love us, who do not care for us, who do not support us, with the hopes to kill us. And you are complicit. Now, I'm asking, because of COVID and our poor status, that we call a public health emergency now. Please make your employees wear masks. Like, we fund them. We fund their paychecks, like make them wear masks. They're accessing homes to poor people. I spent $120 on disinfectant. No other poor person can do that, you know? Whoever families are that are impacted by the Lewiston Fire Department and the Lewiston Police Department's harms, they can contact Lewiston United for Peace and Hope. We're doing the work. You know, it's not confined just to them, but other institutions like county jails. And we, Lewiston, City of Lewiston, funds these positions. We fund these institutions. We can have a say in how people are treated and cared for. And this has everything to do with race and class. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I don't see any other public comments. And we'll move. I'll call the roll from Ward.
Sure. All roll call votes for this meeting will begin with the counselor of Ward 1, actually. The agenda does say Ward 7, but the counselor from Ward 7 has an excused absence this evening. So we're starting with the counselor of Ward 1.
Okay. Counselor Khalid, do you have a comment?
I do. I feel like we need to respond to that comment. My question is, Mayor, or can't city employee, public employees always wear a mask? What is the restrictions for that?
Okay, I'll let, so my understanding is Ms. Dunn has had conversations with city administration. So at this point, you know, I'm not sure that it's appropriate to comment, but your question is very appropriate. So thank you. Dale, if you could address that.
Yes, both fire department and police department, which would be kind of emergency services, are more likely to be in someone's home than many others, or code should be wearing masks. However, there are times with a fire department when they're responding to a fire initially, it's difficult for them to wear masks because they also have to be able to don their scuba gear and other safety equipment. So they have been instructed, and as the mayor said, we have been in contact and we are doing an investigation. So that's probably about all I should really comment on at this time.
Thank you. I have just another general question. You said should, we can't like do a mandatory mask wearing. Is that correct? Yeah.
Yes, I'm sorry. There is a mandatory mask. And we have recently reviewed that with the fire department, and the chief has issued a reminder and more restrictive stuff for staff. So yes, it's a will or shall. I'm bad choice of my words. Sorry.
It's okay. Last comment. You said that several firefighters were exposed to COVID. So when the firefighters come in for a shift, isn't there like a testing or like not a, maybe like I don't know, temperature check, something at the door, for us to be cautious of that?
They are supposed to, and every other city employee are supposed to report to their supervisor symptoms a fever if they have one, or if they feel as if they have a fever. That is a requirement that Ed put in place way back at the beginning. And then supervisors have some obligations on sending people home. We currently don't, although we're looking to develop some beginning of shift, more explicit screening activities. But yes, they're supposed to be monitoring their health, and if they're having issues, talk to this week.
Okay, thank you. And I want to comment on that, you know, that recent complaint from Ms. Dunn. In most cases, you know, we don't allow employee names to be spoken of publicly in a public meeting. But a citizen has every right to complain about a department as a whole. So, you know, I just want to make sure the public understands why, you know, she had the right and was allowed to make her comments. There is a fine line, though, when we're naming individuals. So, Councilor Ray.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilor Khalid covered a lot of what I was going to ask about there, but I think the other question is, and just because I haven't been in any situation like that, is if a city employee is identified as COVID positive and then close contacts are identified who were close contact because of the public service they were providing, does the city offer resources? Does the state offer resources for, for testing or for other measures? I guess cleaning protocol would be the other thing I would think of.
So, Councilor Ray, yes, that's part of that conversation with the CDC. We've been talking to them, obviously, about the individuals that are either known or suspected or may have had close contact. And there's a definition for close contact. And the CDC has been advising us on how we do that contact tracing. And then they would advise us if there were resources that needed to be applied, and which ones they would apply. We have thus far not received any.
Okay.
Recommendations, such recommendations based on the individuals and based on where they've been.
Okay, interesting. And then just 180, will the mayor be voting in place of the excused absence counselors tonight?
Yes, he certainly can if he's interested. Yes, thank you, Alicia.
Thank you for the reminder, Alicia. All right, anything else, counselors, in reference to that? Seeing none, the consent agenda.
I believe we already did the consent agenda, Mr. Mayor. It passed by vote of 5-0. Motion was by Councillor LaJoy, seconded by Councillor Jensen. We've already done consent agenda.
Point of order, I believe that was the minutes.
Right.
My apologies. Sorry about that.
It's all right, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Okay, so consent agenda. There are two items on the consent agenda this evening. Item number one, order authorizing execution of municipal quitclaim deeds for real estate located at 24 River Road, 48 Rachel Boulevard, 143 Howe Street, and 606 River Road. The other item number two, appointments to the Androscoggin Valley Council of Governments, General Assembly, and Executive Committee.
I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Jensen, seconded by Councilor Ray. Okay, call the roll.
Councilor from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
And Ward 5?
Yes.
Motion passed by a vote of 5-0.
You can add me to that as a yes.
And Mr. Mayor as well. Thank you. 6-0.
Okay, agenda item number three, please.
Item number three, public hearing on the renewal application for a special amusement permit for live entertainment for C40 Incorporated, 40 East Avenue. Requested action, to grant a special amusement permit for live entertainment to C40 Incorporated, 40 East Avenue.
So moved.
Okay, moved by Councilor LaJoy, seconded by Councilor Jensen. And Kathy, do you have anything you want to present other than what's presented in the agenda?
No, just the material in the packet. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Any questions or comments from councilors? Okay, to the public. Back to the council. Call the roll, please.
Council from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
Ward 5?
Yes.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Motion passed by a vote of 6-0.
Thank you. Agenda item number 4, please.
Item number 4, public hearing on the renewal application for a special amusement permit for live entertainment for LBK events, 1 Bate Street. Requested action to grant a special amusement permit for live entertainment to LBK events, 1 Bate Street.
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Jensen.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor LaJoy. Questions or comments from the council? To the public? Back to the council. Call the roll, please.
Councilor from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
Ward 5?
Yes.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Motion passed by a vote of 6-0.
Thank you. Agenda item number 5, please.
Item number 5, condemnation hearing for the building located at 97 Sabata Street. There are 2 items for requested action. The first one is to conduct a hearing to determine if the building located at 97 Sabata Street has met the dangerous building statutes as defined in Title 17, Section 2851 et al.
Thank you. So with these, we wouldn't entertain any type of motion at the beginning, right?
Correct, right.
Okay, thank you. So if we can bring in Attorney Carey. So I see, okay. All right, so added to the meeting is our attorney, Michael Carey, Director of Planning, Dave Hediger, and Code Enforcement, Benjamin Westman. So Attorney Carey, I should go right into the material at this point, correct? Okay, thank you.
Yes, Mayor.
All right, thank you. We are meeting this evening to conduct a hearing to determine whether the structure at 97 Sabata Street is a nuisance or dangerous building within the meaning of the applicable Maine statute found in Section 2851 of Title 17 of the Maine Revised Statute, and whether the structure poses a serious threat to public health and safety within the meaning of Section 2856. Of that title and must be secured. If the council determines that the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building, it will then determine what actions the property owner must take. Before I proceed, I will note that the city attorney has taken part in this hearing and is in an office adjacent to me. If I mute my audio or turn my video off, it is only to confer with him. With your packets, you will find a copy of Section 2851 of Title 17 under subsection 2-A, a structure or any part thereof is a nuisance or a dangerous building if it is structurally unsafe, unstable, unsanitary, constitutes a fire hazard, is unsuitable or improper for the use or occupancy to which it is put, constitutes a hazard to health or safety because of inadequate maintenance, dilapidation, obsolescence, or abandonment, or is otherwise dangerous to life or property. With your packets, you will find a copy of Section 2856, which reads in part, a municipality has the right to secure buildings and secured buildings that pose a serious threat to public health and safety. These are the standards that we will use to decide whether the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building and must be secured. And at this point, I'll turn it over to Attorney Carey.
Thank you, Mayor. Section 2851 and 2856 provide the standard for the council to use to determine whether a building is a nuisance or dangerous. Mayor just read this standard, and a copy of that statute is in your packet. The code department has the burden of proof to prove that a building is a nuisance or dangerous. The question is, what is the standard of that burden? Often, courts use the preponderance of evidence standard in civil cases, while criminal conviction requires proof beyond a reasonable doubt. In this case, statute does not specify a burden of proof for a dangerous building case, and nor do the reported cases. However, when reviewing dangerous building cases on appeal, the law court uses a substantial evidence appellate standard, which provides some guidance. For example, in a dangerous building case, the law court wrote, "Substantial evidence exists when a reasonable mind would rely on that evidence as sufficient support for a conclusion. When reviewing administrative findings of fact, we examine the entire record to determine whether, on the basis of all testimony and exhibits before it, the council could fairly and reasonably find the facts as it did. We must affirm findings of fact if they are supported by any confident evidence on the record, even if the record contains inconsistent evidence or evidence contrary to the result reached by the council." Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. And before we start, I first have a question for all city councilors. The building at 97 Savada Street is owned by Jennifer Cremona. Is that correct?
Yes.
Additional parties of interest are Bank of America, N.A., Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc., Wilmington Savings Fund Society, FSB, doing business as Christina Trust. Not in its individual capacity, but solely for BCAT 2014-4TT. Does the city council member, does any city council member know the owner or any party of interest or have knowledge about this matter that means you could not fairly and impartially hear the facts and decide the matter based on the evidence presented in this hearing? You know, if I could just get a verbal response by calling the roll.
Sure. Counselor from Ward 1?
No.
Ward 2?
No.
Ward 3?
No.
Ward 4?
No.
Ward 5?
No.
And Mr. Mayor?
No.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. The owner or another party in interest should now raise their hands electronically and they will be unmuted. I will ask that each party in interest introduce yourself, including your name, address, and position. So. So I have Carrie Folsom raising her hand, Dale.
Yes, this is Attorney Folsom. Can you hear me?
I can, thank you.
Thank you.
And if you could just share who you represent here at this point.
Yes, I'm attorney for the first lien mortgage holder, Bank of America, as well as their servicing agency. They handle all the day-to-day mortgage related tasks, Carrington Mortgage Services.
All right, thank you, Attorney Folsom. The notice for this hearing instructed a party in interest that wished to use the telephone to call 207-513-3021 before 5 p.m. today to obtain the telephone number and passcode. Deputy City Administrator Doty, did anyone call that number prior to our meeting?
No, sir.
Okay. If a party in interest cannot use Zoom or telephone or request an accommodation, it was directed to contact City Attorney Michael Carey to arrange to attend the hearing. City Attorney Michael Carey, did anyone of a party in interest contact you to make arrangements?
No, Your Honor.
Thank you. You can call me Mr. Mayor, not Your Honor. Thank you. Kind of has a nice ring to it, but For the record, city staff were at the entrance to City Hall this evening between 6:45 and 7:15 this evening, and nobody presented to attend this hearing in person. Now the procedures that the City Council will follow in conducting this hearing are as follows. Any documents to be used in this proceeding will be marked as an exhibit. At the October 6, 2020 hearing, I accepted into evidence the Planning and Code Enforcement Department's previously provided exhibits A through Z and E through J for 97 Sabata Street. I now accept into evidence Planning and Code Enforcement Department's additional previously provided exhibits D, K, L, and M. Additionally, I accept Director Hediger's memorandum and timeline, which were included in the council packet, into evidence as Exhibit N. The presentation of evidence for the property will occur in the following order. Okay. Go directly to three. Okay, thank you. Then the City Council may take evidence from the City Planning and Code Enforcement Department staff and Bank of America on these two questions. Any relevant evidence regarding new conditions in the property since October 6, 2020, and two, regarding whether Bank of America has demonstrated the ability and willingness to satisfactorily rehabilitate the property. A, the City Planning and Code Enforcement Department staff will provide any relevant evidence regarding these two questions. B, Bank of America will provide any relevant evidence regarding those two questions as well. Bank of America can then ask of Planning and Code Enforcement Department and any witnesses. D, the Planning and Code Enforcement Department can then ask questions of Bank of America and any witnesses it presents. E, the Planning and Code Department can then make additional comments regarding any Bank of America presentation. F, Bank of America can then make additional comments regarding the presentation of Planning and Code Enforcement Department. City Council members can then ask questions of the Planning and Code Enforcement Department, Bank of America, and witnesses. H, each side can then make closing remarks of not more than 2 minutes. After all information has been presented, the record will be closed. The City Council will deliberate, take a vote on whether the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building. If the council determines that the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building and must be secured, it shall deliberate and take a vote on the appropriate order to be made to remedy the situation. This is an administrative hearing and not a court proceeding or trial. Therefore, the formal rules of evidence will not apply. As mayor, I will determine the appropriateness and admissibility of evidence on the advice of our city attorney. I now ask that the Lewiston Planning and Code Enforcement Department present the City Council with information relevant to this matter.
Thank you, Mayor. On October 6, 2020, the dangerous building hearing was continued until tonight. On October 23rd, 2020, a notice of this hearing was recorded in the Androscoggin County Registry of Deeds in Book 10526, page 174, a copy of which is included in your packets as Exhibit K. Service on the owner was attempted at three addresses. The owner registered P.O. Box 160, Tenants Harbor, Maine, as her address and the city assessor and with code. Mailings to that P.O. Box are returned as undeliverable. The Tenants Harbor Master does not know the owner's name. On August 20th, 2020 and August 21st, 2020, Ms. Cremona indicated her address was 81 East Avenue, Lewiston, Maine, Apartment 8, where she registered two vehicles at that address. On September 29th, 2020, the apartment was vacant when the sheriff tried to effect service. Bank of America effected service of her at 21 Lisbon Street, Lisbon, Maine. A man at that address indicated he knew the owner but would not give an address to the sheriff. The sheriff served a woman at that address who identified herself by a name other than Jennifer Cremona. City staff has contacted the owner through her real estate agent, but that person indicated that she did not have an address for the owner and that she lived with friends, family, or on a boat. The sheriff learned the phone number for Miss Cremona. I have called twice. Both times I got a message from a woman identifying herself as Jennifer Cremona, but the voicemail was full and I could not leave a message. Documents showing attempts at service are attached as Exhibit D. Miss Cremona's address is unknown and it is not ascertainable with reasonable diligence. On September 22nd, 2020, Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc. was served with a notice of hearing at the main address of its former registered agent, see Exhibit G. On October 1st, 2020, from its Delaware address, the registered agent sent a notice rejecting service for Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc., even though that company is not registered to do business in Delaware. Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc. was organized in Massachusetts and was administratively dissolved on June 18, 2012. On June 10, 2016, it filed supplemental information of a principal office address at 700 Longwater Drive, Norwell, Mass., but a U.S. Postal Service mailing to that address was returned as undeliverable. Additional documents showing attempts at service are attached as Exhibit L. Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc.'s address is unknown or is unascertainable with reasonable diligence. Because the addresses of Jennifer Cremona and Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc.'s are unknown and not ascertainable with reasonable diligence, the city effected service on Jennifer Cremona and on Nation One Mortgage Company, Inc. by publication. On October 22nd, 2020, November 3rd, 2020, November 10th, 2020, the notice was published in the Sun Journal, a copy of which is included in your packets as Exhibit M. Carrie Folsom, Esquire, attorney for Bank of America, received written notice of tonight's hearing by electronic mail. On October 6th, Lewiston Code Enforcement Officer Benjamin Westman described the conditions at the property or of the property. Tonight, he'll give you an update on the new conditions since October 6th and whether Bank of America has demonstrated the ability and willingness to satisfactorily rehabilitate the property.
Am I all set to speak? I am City of Lewiston Code Enforcement Officer Benjamin Westman. My qualifications and certifications are located in your packets as Exhibit I. At the October 6, 2020 council meeting, legal counsel representing Bank of America with regards to 97 Sabata Street stated they would be speaking with their representative on October 7th, 2020 and informed them that the building needed to be secured immediately. I asked the council to reference the timeline that was included in your packet and has been entered in as Exhibit N, so you can see the attempts the city staff made to ensure the bank secured the property. On October 13th, 2020, I emailed the preservation company working on behalf of Bank of America, informing them that the property remained unsecured. I suggested a walkthrough of the property would be advisable to ensure all parties were on the same page as to the work that needed to be done. On October 20, 2020, I again emailed the preservation company that the property remained unsecured and needed to be secured immediately. On October 22nd, 2020, I spoke with a contractor named Terry, who was contacted about working on the property to correct the violations by Bank of America's preservation company. Terry and I scheduled an appointment for a walkthrough of the property for October 28th, 2020. The contractor did not show up for the scheduled inspection and did not contact myself to reschedule. When I arrived for the appointment, I observed the property was still unsecured as of October 22nd, 2020. On November 5th, 2020, I reached out to the contractor to inquire about the missed appointment. He stated he had gotten the calendar invite for the October 28th, 2020 walkthrough, but never got approval from the preservation company to come to Maine to do the walkthrough. As of today, the property remains unsecured. There are several concerns for unsecured properties in our community when structures are abandoned, including increased incidents of arson resulting in higher costs to fire prevention, the possibility to people being in unsecured buildings, with the possibility for injury or death, an increased burden on police for surveillance and response, potentially limiting their availability to respond to other emergencies. The fact that the property remains unsecured today demonstrates Bank of America's inability and unwillingness to satisfactorily rehabilitate the property. As a point of reference to the dangers and costs already incurred to the city due to other unsecured buildings in town, I provide the following. In fall 2019, a vacant unsecured building burned down after our office repeatedly asked the owner to secure the property. Earlier this year, a vacant unsecured building was set on fire, which resulted in significant fire and water damage to the structure, which may cause the building to have to be demolished. And lastly, earlier this month, a homeless person was found deceased in a vacant unsecured building. Before you make your decision regarding this property, I ask the council to take into consideration the efforts our office has already taken to have this property secured, and also the problems we have had with other unsecured properties within our community within the last year.
Okay, thank you. And if we could bring back Attorney Folsom. And I've asked Dale to keep Attorney Folsom present in the meeting from this point on. Attorney Folsom, representing Bank of America, do you have any relevant evidence regarding those two questions and any other information to provide?
There we go. I lost connection for a moment. I'm sorry. Can you hear me?
I can. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't have too much to add to what Mr. Westman already said. The unfortunate difficulty for my client is because this is an FHA loan, they can't do anything without HUD authority. I don't know the gentleman that they tried to liaison with that never showed up for the appointment, but they have several bids and RFPs that they have accepted, and they've been presented to HUD for authorization. I spoke with someone at Bank of America in Carrington today, stressing to them the emergency nature, especially now that weather is getting colder. And I am familiar with the that property where the unfortunate individual was found deceased just a couple of weeks ago. And reminding them that it's extremely urgent that the property be secured. As I mentioned at our last hearing, I'm a resident and a homeowner in Lewiston, and I know exactly where this property is. So I've reminded them of the importance to the community for them to get this resolved. And I'm hoping to have resolution by the end of the week, but I understand for them to secure the property, because what will happen is when they get the final approval from FHA, they'll do a detailed estimate to see whether it's worth it to rehabilitate or when an actual destruction is really the only cost-effective option. But I understand that the city needs to move forward in terms of what's in front of us today. I don't have any personal knowledge about the actual physical condition of the property, but just my cursory knowledge as a city resident, I realize the property's in pretty extreme distress and does need to be secured. And I've reminded my client of that, and they're working as fast as they can.
Okay, thank you. And do you have any questions of planning and code enforcement department or any other witnesses?
The gentleman that never showed up for his appointment, or I assume it was a gentleman named Terry, what company was he affiliated with? Did he say?
He said he was contacted by MCS, which is the primary contact for the preservation that I've had throughout the process with this property.
Okay, because I was looking through the materials this afternoon where you and reading through, and I just didn't, if I knew who he was, I might be able to back channel and get more information to get him reconnected with you. I'll see if I can find out. You said you think he came through a property management company, did he say that, and he wasn't in Maine?
I said he was out of Vermont. And I can email you his telephone number as well. He was supposed to, after I spoke to him on the 5th, he was supposed to get back to me. He was supposed to make another attempt with the preservation company to get authorization to come to Maine to review the property, and he had never responded again. Whether he didn't get a response from, you know, his company or whatnot, but
I'll see if I can find out who he is, and have him try and connect with you. It's frustrating for you, I'm sure, that the bank's not moving any more quickly, but they can't so much as blink an eye without HUD's authorization, and those wheels just turn so slowly.
The only question I have regarding the HUD...
if we can hold on one second, we'll get an opportunity for planning and code to ask questions, but just we'll stay with the script. And it's coming right up, so hold on one second. So Attorney Folsom, any other questions or comments?
No, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm all set for right now.
All right, thank you. So now planning and code can now ask Bank of America or any witnesses questions. Go ahead, Mr. Westman.
I was going to say, I'll defer to David if he had something else, or if he wants me to go.
Go right ahead.
Okay. I had inquired with HUD regarding the status of the FHA loan, and I spoke with Chris Klein with HUD. He had no outstanding loan with the property. He asked me to reach out to Main State Housing as well, because they could have been the local facilitator of the loan. And Main State Housing shows that they discharged the loan as of June 28th, 2013. So I'm a little confused as far as the tie that HUD has to it when they're showing the loan is being discharged.
The word discharge is probably a misnomer. Main State Housing Authority, when loans are performing, are sort of the in-state company that makes sure that a lot of the HUD regulations and so forth are being complied with. But once a loan goes into default, Main State Housing Authority gets out of the picture. They don't get involved with default loans. So when they say discharge, I think they mean more in the sense of their involvement was done. The mortgage is definitely still active. It's not discharged a record in the title. Now this Mr. Again, I assume it's a Mr. Mr. Chris Klein. Do you know
yep.
where he was? Was he in New Hampshire?
Chris Klein is the senior housing program specialist for the single family support division for U.S. Department of HUD out of Boston. I work directly with the LED program through HUD, so I reached out to that contact, and they put me in contact with Christopher. I can put you in contact with him as well, because they're showing the FHA loan associated with the property was paid off in 2002. But he said he can't find any evidence that there's currently an FHA mortgage tied to the property. And that's when he had me reach out to Main State Housing.
Okay, yeah, if you can connect me with Mr. Klein, I can see it could be that we're using legal or trade terms that don't mean the same thing, you know, from one side to the other. There's a lot right. of lingo in my industry. So
yep.
I'll see what I can find out for you as well, because it's definitely an FHA loan. I was speaking with my rep again on it today, and that's the stumbling block. So I've been advised, so.
Yep.
Okay, any further questions from planning or code of Bank of America?
Yeah, not so much a question, but maybe a comment and observation, both for Ms. Folsom and the council. I mean, clearly, this building's been vacant for some time. Recognizing Ms. Folsom can only do what she can, given her role and capacity. Nothing has changed since the 6th. I believe the council would have acted favorably on this action on the 6th if it wasn't the issue of service to Ms. Cremona. We've tried that. We've exercised and exhausted all of our options here. I don't have a lot of faith in Bank of America. They haven't really taken this matter seriously from our perspective. It's interesting, Ben and I were out there today, and they seem more concerned about mowing the lawn out there than they are actually securing the building. Situations like this are frustrating for us. As you folks know, you have a draft of the findings of facts and conclusion in here. And really, when you go through that, you only need to meet one criteria to make this finding tonight, to make a determination that this building is structurally unsafe, unsanitary, is a fire hazard, improper and unsuitable for occupancy, is a health hazard, is dangerous. It clearly is those things. I'd suggest that the council act upon this. I'm sure Ms. Folsom has shared this with Bank of America. But at this point, I would hope that the council does move forward with the taking action on the Dangerous Building Act this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Bank of America can now make any additional comments regarding the presentation of planning and code. Do you have anything?
I had nothing further, Mr. Mayor, but thank you.
Okay, thank you, Attorney Folsom. City Council, is now it's your opportunity to ask questions of planning and code enforcement and Bank of America or any other witnesses. Questions or comments or questions of the council? Councilor Jensen.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I don't have any questions myself. I guess just a few brief comments. I want to commend Mr. Hediger and Mr. Westman for the work that they've done. It's unfortunate that nothing's happened in the last 40 days. It's just been 40 more days of a dangerous building. A lot of extra work that people have had to do for kind of wasted. So I'll be glad to see that building get taken care of finally. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. At this point, it's an opportunity for council members to ask questions of planning or code or Bank of America. Any other, Councilor Ray?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. For planning and code, from here, if this building is deemed or the structure is deemed a dangerous building and it moves forward with condemnation, and then at what point does it move forward with demolition?
So as part of the findings that you that the council acts upon, there is a 30-day period, basically. So the way that order is written, and I believe you folks have a copy of this in your packets. Let's see, that would be on, I guess, page 3, number 29, where it references within 30 days of service of this order, the owner and the successors and assignees shall demolish the structure. So basically, they have 30 days. During that period, if they want to, they can come to us and come up with a plan potentially to either save or demolish the plan in another time period. That has to be reviewed to staff satisfaction. So basically, they'll be dealing directly with us at that point to see if they actually have a viable plan. We then have can make a determination upon that within 30 days to say your plan is great, your plan is not satisfactory, and we need to proceed. So basically, to your point, it's a 30-day window here that we're going to be working with.
Okay, and the owner and their successors shall demolish the structure, remove all debris, stabilize the site. The owner is clearly not here, still, even with all of those wonderful Sun Journal notices that were put out, the city would take on that cost. Is that true? And then try to recoup that?
Yep. So that's we have. So it's happened numerous ways over the years with the council acting upon dangerous buildings. Sometimes the bank, the owner, will take responsibility for the demolition of it. Sometimes they actually ask us to demolish it for them, you know, and they'll pay us for it because they feel that we have a better grasp as to what's going on, because it could be an out-of-state bank, or we act upon it and then we put a lien on the property to recover those costs. You folks have provided funds over the years for demolition of structures. So we have enough money in the budget to accommodate the demolition of this structure in the event that the bank doesn't do it on their own.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Any other questions from the council? Okay. Seeing none, at this point, either party, planning or Bank of America, can make some final closing comments. Mr. Hediger, Director Hediger, do you have any closing comments?
I'm all set at this time.
Okay, Attorney Folsom?
No, I don't have anything further, Mr. Mayor, thank you.
Thank you. All right, all information and evidence has been presented, and I'll close the record at this point. The City Council will now deliberate and take a vote on whether the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building. If the council determines that the structure is a nuisance or dangerous building and must be secured, it shall deliberate and take a vote on the appropriate order to make to be made to remedy the situation. So it's up for discussion and a motion. And I think Attorney Carrie can chime in. The requested action with regard to the property at 97 Sabata Street is to adopt the findings of fact, conclusions of law, and order of a demolition proposed by the City Planning and Code Enforcement Department, which order established any corrective action to be taken by the property owner and the time frame for such action, and which authorized the city administrator to take such corrective action if the property owner fails to do so, and to recoup city costs through a special tax or collective action.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make that motion.
Okay. I'll second the motion.
So a motion's been made by Councilor Ray and seconded by Councilor LaJoy. And I'll just check with our city attorney. That motion's all appropriate. Or do you have an opinion on that?
No, Your Honor. I think it's. I would agree that it's appropriate as drafted in the cover.
All right. Thank you. Questions or comments on the motion from councilors? Seeing none. To the well, we don't take public comment at all through him. Correct.
Correct.
Sorry, councilors. I just want to make sure. So seeing no questions or comments from the council, Madam Clerk, if you could, Councilor Ray.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to ask the finance director about that demolition fund, where its status is currently, if possible.
Certainly, there are funds availability. As of the last quarter, there was over $1 million available.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from the council? Okay, seeing none, Madam Clerk, if you could call the roll.
Your council from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
Ward 5?
Yes.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Motion passed by vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you. Attorney Folsom, we appreciate you attending this evening. I know it's been a struggle for you through this process, so thank you. Dave and Benjamin, thank you very much for taking time to attend this hearing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, agenda and Attorney Carey, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Agenda item number 6, please.
Item number 6, reports and updates.
Councilor Ray.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a brief update on school committee work. We met last night. We received an update on the intake and then expenditure of both CARES and CRF funds and how that's going. We talked about our LHS principal search. We currently have an interim principal at the high school, and so looking to establish a more permanent person. And then a superintendent's evaluation is something we discussed. We'd like to take a 360 evaluation approach this time, asking folks who report into the superintendent to anonymously share feedback for areas of growth and opportunity. The other thing to update you all on is that as situations have been arising in each individual school building site due to COVID-19, where folks have had symptoms or have tested positive, the school administration has been in close contact with the Maine CDC and the Maine Department of Education and is handling each unique instance as it comes. As a result of an outbreak designation at the high school, Coming late Friday night, Superintendent Linglis decided to close the high school and LRTC yesterday and today for a deep cleaning, with students returning on Thursday. This was not mandated by the state, but with an outbreak designation, it felt odd. And I would agree with that, to not take some action to try to clean up the school a bit and make sure it was in good tip-top shape for folks to return. We have not gone full remote for any cohort or any entire site otherwise, but we've got to ask the question each week, and we do. So thanks everyone for trying to support us through that.
Okay, thank you, Councilor Ray. Any other reports or updates from councilors? Okay, agenda item number 7.
Item number 7, any other city business councilors or others may have relating to Lewiston City Government?
Councilor Lee?
Oh, I thought you said Lee. I was like, what? So this is related to COVID. And now that we're seeing more increased stay at home and more cases happening, and people even working from home, I want to propose updating one of our ordinances in regards to street parking. I had a constituent reach out to me where her car was towed and she had to pay a large fee. And especially right now with jobs and the current situation in the pandemic, it's just terrible paying fees for a parking. But so I don't know what the process is in updating the ordinance, but I want, you know, signs from 24 hours to 48 hours. In my ward, especially on Main Street, there's two constructions, one for the hospital and one for Dunkin' Donuts, I believe. And a lot of, a lot of people park on the street. So a lot of cars being towed. Yeah, I just wanted to bring that up and talk about that.
Okay, so have you spoken to other councilors for support for that type of change to put it on the agenda and address?
No.
Okay. All right, so if it's okay with you, duly noted, and I'll touch base with administration tomorrow and have a further discussion with you. Is that acceptable?
Yes, that's
fine. Okay, thank you. And just to be clear, you're asking that a 24-hour parking rule be changed to a 48-hour. Is that what I heard?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So if there's also other suggestions from other counselors, I would also like to hear what other counselors think. Maybe right now, maybe in the future. But it's an idea that I've been thinking about.
Yeah, and I mean, we can gauge interest from the council if there's anyone that wants to chime in on this at this point.
Mr. Mayor, I would be super supportive of looking at that rule. I'm familiar with what Councilor Khalid is speaking about, and folks who are doing the right thing and not leaving their homes that much shouldn't be penalized because they don't have parking associated with their housing at this point, in my opinion.
Okay, thank you. And do you have anything further, Councilor Ray?
I had a different thing, but if other councilors want to go ahead on this one.
Councilor Jensen?
Let me jump in. I have something else, but I'm glad Councilor Clid brought that up. About 2 years ago, I had my own car towed right around Christmas time. I was making about 17 grand a year at the time, so I was not making much money. So having to pay the $200 or so, it was probably more than that, to get my car out, was awful, but it was almost worse to pay the ticket to the city, because not only could I not go get my car, I had to wait to go to the police station. It was cold. I had to walk from Shawmut Street. Luckily, I lived downtown, so I wasn't far. Had to wait there for about an hour after calling the dispatch before someone was finally there and able to take my money. It was an awful experience. And let's just say if I'd been able to just go get my car and go to work the next day, we would have been good. But I remember at the time thinking that it was almost evil that I had to pay that fee. So I'm really glad that Councilor Clid brought that up, because I'm certainly supportive of that. I don't think that she should have to meet with anyone about this. I think there's enough support for it. And for bringing it up at a meeting, I don't think that we should have to meet with a bunch of people beforehand. I get, you know, the research aspect, but as a counselor, when we bring up an issue, we kind of expect it to be addressed, especially when we're bringing it up at a meeting. So just in regards to that, that's just, of course, my opinion. But I did want to also bring up that I know we're having a hearing on the 1st for possibly an appointment to the school committee. I know last time we talked about maybe having some kind of formal procedure so that they don't go haywire. So I guess I was hoping that we could maybe get something in place by that hearing coming up on the 1st. I mean, I can certainly put something together and email it in myself.
We can. I didn't know if anything was done. Yeah, we can, but the formal procedure, what do you mean by formal procedure? Because I think we do have a procedure. The mayor reviews applications and makes a nomination, and the council either votes to accept it or deny it.
The hearing itself, but I mean, like my own hearing, I wasn't even allowed to speak to defend myself. I know Tom Shannon had some issues with his hearing as well. So I just think it's more fair to applicants to have some kind of procedure set up where they're allowed to respond at several points. I just don't think like having one point of letting them talk like they're a member of the public, it's not a good system to me. So I'd prefer it to change.
Okay, I think I disagree with that. But first, let's go back to your parking ticket thing. You mentioned how you were treated, but did you violate a rule? I mean, why did your car get towed? I think if we're gonna suggest that, all these terrible things happened, what was the cause of it? Was it an accidental tow or?
There was a winter parking ban. I was working my second job, again, making very little money a year. I was very stressed out, and I just kind of forgot the ban that I had to move my car.
Okay. I agree with you. Precedent has been that a counselor wants to have something on the agenda, they reach out to another counselor and get at least two counselors to, you know, to support that. That's not controlled by the mayor. So if the council disagrees with that, that's fine. You know, I'm that's just what precedent has been for years, that councils go through a little process, because otherwise than that, we could have things being slapped on the agenda all the time. So we have that now. We have two councilors that are supportive of that. But I'm going to caution the council not to have knee-jerk reactions and change an ordinance. I mean, cars are towed for a reason. And in this case, I believe it was looked into by staff. So I think there's more to the story than just a person got her car towed and spent way too much money and it was, an attack on their rights. But, I think there was a legitimate tow from what little information I had. But we'll put this on the agenda to have further discussion. But I just think we have to be cautious how we throw things on the agenda. And again, this is just my opinion. The council will make the final decision. So on that subject, anyone want to have a comment about anything I said? At this point would be the time to do that. Otherwise, I'll move it to Councilor Ray. Okay, Councilor Ray.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In talking about the superintendent's evaluation last night at school committee, I thought about our own city administrator evaluation and was just curious. Traditionally, the council president runs that process. And so I was curious if that was coming down the pike and if we needed to hold time for a meeting for that review, what process we'd be using, all of that good stuff.
Okay. So can you reach out to the city administrator when he gets back in the time frame? How long has he been our city administrator? When were you expecting that his evaluation process come up?
So he was hired on for July 1st, but traditionally the process happens at the end of the calendar year, unless I'm wildly mistaken. I ran it in the last year for City Administrator Barrett's last evaluation before he departed us. The two were not related, but that's something that someone has to start working on.
I noticed the clerk was nodding her head up and down. So, all right. So Council President LaJoy, will you reach out to city administrators to discuss the timing of his evaluation?
Yes, I can do that, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Any other city business councilors have? Okay, seeing none, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn. Move to adjourn, excuse me.
Okay, moved by Councilor Jensen to adjourn.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Pattengill. Call the roll, please.
Councilor from Ward 1?
Yes.
Ward 2?
Yes.
Ward 3?
Yes.
Ward 4?
Yes.
Ward 5?
Yes.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Motion passed by a vote of 6-0.
All right. Thank you, everybody.